The next speaker is Alexander Philipp. He studied electrical engineering and communication technology at the Leipzig University of Applied Science. During his more than 50 years experience of development of CAN and CAN open protocol stacks, Alexander joined Emotas Embedded Communication in 2015 and is in charge of the development of most of the CAN-based protocol stacks like CANopen, CANopenFD, J1939, and UDS. Alexander also participates in the CAN and Automation Working Groups and is the chairman of the CAN and Automation Interest Group, CANopenFD. He's talking about the theoretical approach for node ID negotiation in CANopen networks. Alexander, stage is yours.
Thank you, Christian. Okay, before I start my presentation, I want to have some words why we actually wrote this paper when the CAN Automation had this call for papers for the ICC 2020. And the background is actually over several years now, we have customers who build up systems which are highly scalable, like battery clusters or heating systems and so on, and they decided to use CANopen because it's very mature and reliable. The only problem they had is, where do I get the node IDs for my devices? And so when this call for papers came, we just wrote down our ideas how you could achieve something like the same functionality like in J1939, where the nodes itself claim their addresses. Yeah, that's the background of that. So my agenda for the next 40 minutes, or about 40 minutes, is what is actually CANopen node ID. I mean, if you're already working with CANopen, then you know that, but maybe some from the automotive area don't even know what a node ID is. And how is a node ID actually assigned? Then I will talk a little bit about the reason for this approach and how does it work, and show you a little example of a proof of concept. A CANopen node ID is actually the address of a CANopen device in the network. It has to be unique in the network, and it is a 7-bit value, which actually means that the node ID can only go up to the number 127. And it actually starts at number 1, so 0 is forbidden. So you can only have 127 devices in one network. It should be unique, and unique is the reason because many of the services in CANopen using this node ID to create the CAN identifier in the, for the communication. For example, the error control mechanism uses the CAN ID hex 700 plus the node ID of the device who's sending the heartbeat, for example. And that's why it has to be unique. And the CANopen node ID actually enables you to switch from the initialization state in CANopen to the communication state. And the problem here is if the device doesn't have a node ID, it would get actually stuck in a substate reset communication. If you're familiar with CANopen, you know what I'm talking about. And you're not able to communicate at all via CANopen. So without a node ID, you're not able to communicate with the outside world. And the reason is that in this substate, there is actually a check defined. So if your node ID is in a range from 1 to 127, then you're able to leave this reset communication state and enter the pre-operational state, which is the default first communicating state of a CANopen device. Now, the question is, how get a device its own node ID? The simple approach is actually just coded hard in software. That's very easy, but the problem here is, of course, if you have multiple of the same devices in a network, then they would all have the same node ID. if they're running the same software, which is not the desired behavior. Another possibility would be to have some kind of hardware configurations. And what I'm thinking of when I say hardware configuration, it could be a DIP switch or Terry switch or some coded plugs or something like that. You could also create your own configuration process. For example, download some configuration file to the device or have some proprietary possibilities to get access to the device and create or save a node ID. Another possibility is the so-called layer setting service, or LSS, which is defined in the document CIA 305. And I think the next speaker will talk a little bit about LSS and how it works. But to make it short, layer setting service is a service designed for devices to assign node IDs and bit rates. The problem here is, first of all, the device which should receive a node ID has to support the service, which sometimes is not possible due to resources or whatever. And the other thing is, you always need an LSS manager in the network to assign node IDs. And this LSS manager has somehow decide which device gets which node ID. And there are networks out there where the node ID is actually not really important. And that's why we created this approach. Because sometimes, or a lot of times in the last years, I heard there is no hardware configuration possible. Oh, there's this. Okay. Or maybe the whole thing is molded in something, or you don't have access anymore because it's, let's say, it's down the sea somewhere, subsea, or don't have hardware access. And I hear a lot of times that there is no LSS manager possible or available anymore. Or maybe you have some kind of networks where there is actually no CAN open manager available, that they are all, let's call it self-running devices, like a battery cluster. They are just communicating vice versa, but there's no manager controlling anything. Another reason is if you have, for example, an LSS manager available, then this manager has to keep track of the already assigned node IDs pretty much. And there are a lot of networks, dynamic networks out there, where you don't know how many devices end up, or maybe you unplug a device and replug a device or something like that. So the real number of nodes in the network is actually unknown. And as I said, there are systems out there where the node ID is actually not really interesting for the application layer. I think about the profile CIA 454, which is also called Energy Bus, and others, where the node ID is only enabling the communication, and which node ID a battery has is absolutely unimportant, or which node ID the motor has is absolutely unimportant, because they have other mechanisms where they can figure out what kind of device this is and address it by predefined CAN IDs later on. So the node ID itself is not really necessary. It's not necessary that the battery has the node ID 2. Could be 3 in the next battery, 5 or 7, doesn't matter. how this approach works. The first we did, we said, okay, the 11-bit identifier and can open, they are all, yeah, more or less used already. There is no so that much free anymore. And we want to be very flexible with that. So what we said, okay, what doesn't hurt usually in CAN open networks or CAN open FD networks is the usage of extended CAN IDs, so 29-bit identifier. Another design decision we had, we don't want to have collisions. So what do you do if you want to avoid collisions? You just skip the payload, pretty much. So we are only using the CAN ID itself, just to avoid collisions and use the advantages of the arbitration of the CAN protocol, the CAN bus data link. Yeah. Another design decision we did is it doesn't matter if you would use it on CAN open networks or CAN open FD networks, but the main thing is you can only use classical extended frame format CAN identifier. The reason behind that is actually the easy bit, so that the bit which shows that a device is an error passive could cause collisions on the bus, and that's what we highly trying to not to do or create. For the decision, if a device gets the desired node ID it wants to have, we have decided we kind of, in analogy to layer setting service, we're using the LSS address or actually all four subindexes of object 1018, which is the identity object in CAN open, which contains information about the vendor, the product code, the revision number, and the serial number. So you need all four subindexes of this object to successfully participate in this process I will describe. What we did with this CAN ID is we divided the CAN ID in two parts, the so-called data code, and then we have the 1018 data. And then we created three comments or three kind of messages, two comment messages. One is request used node IDs on the right-hand side. I don't know if you can see my cursor. And we have another kind of comment, actual used node IDs. If a device would send out request used node IDs, then all the devices which are participating or able to participate in this process and already have an assigned or a negotiated node ID would then answer with the second command the actual used node IDs, and so the application who wants to negotiate a node ID knows which node IDs are already assigned or negotiated. So the application could then pick another node ID, for example, if it sees the 5 is already assigned to another node. And another thing, or another type of message we created is the 1018 message, which actually contains of 8 bits, which is a part of the, or contains a part of a 1018 parameter. And then it has some bits to indicate which part of the 1018 parameter it actually is. So is it from subindex 1 or 2 or 3 or 4? And then which, because every entry is 32 bits long, and we are only having 8 bits, so we have another bit combination who tells us which byte is it. Is it the first byte, the second byte, the third byte, or the fourth byte of this unsigned 32? And what actually happens in our process, and in my paper, if you look in my paper, there's a locking of a proof of concept where you can see then the whole process, but it wouldn't fit on slides, so I highly recommend to read the paper. What actually happens when a device wants to negotiate a node ID, then it would request the used node IDs, then it get maybe an information which node IDs are used, and then starting a process where it sends one of these 16 messages, waits a while, and then sends the next one. The order doesn't matter, it just sends out. And another device who also wants to negotiate could also start that. And what happens here is if one of the devices receives, for example, this message, or the first, let's say, take the first message in the left block, receives that, then it would compare with its own 1018 parameter. And if the received message or the received byte is smaller than its own, then the receiving node would stop its negotiation and wait a while the negotiation goes on, and then start a new negotiation. So at the end, the device who is able to send out all 16 messages in more or less a block has won the negotiation and can claim, claim and it's the desired node IDs and would send out the same message as it would send if somebody asked you for the node ID. Okay, so what we are doing here is actually, so somebody is monitoring, is somebody negotiating? If not, I can start my negotiation. If somebody also wants to participate and negotiate, sends a message out and both compare, and then at the end of the day, you have a winner. Actually pretty fast. Okay, what happens if a node ID is in the network, but my application wants to have the same node ID? You can try this. For example, you ask in the network, okay, which node IDs are used, and you see, okay, node ID 5 is used. Then I start my negotiation. Nobody is complaining. Let's call it like this. Then I send out my application for some reason wants to have the number 5. Then it sends out the number 5. And what would happen is that the other node number 5 would see that, okay, this node ID is already used. So I send out the same message, I have the same node ID, and both of the devices lose their node ID. And then the process starts over again. And as I said, we don't have any payload, so all the information needed for the whole negotiation process is actually in the arbitration field of the CAN frame. And so in this way, we are trying to avoid errors, or actually haven't seen any. So we have no collisions in this process. And as I said, if you want to use it or would use it in a CAN OpenFD network, you have to use classical CAN frames, which is not unusual nowadays, because the next speaker will also talk about this in LSSFD. There are other reasons why you should use classical CAN frames for LSS, for example. A little bit about the usage of CAN IDs. At the beginning, I heard, oh, with your approach, you would use a lot of CAN IDs. First of all, it's not really true. I only use 13 of the 29 bits available. in the CAN ID. And at the end of the day, if you make the calculation, how many CAN IDs do I actually use? I use 8,000 out of, yeah, what is it, 536 million. So at the end of the day, for this process, I only need 0.0015% of the extended CAN IDs, which are possible. And since we are using the lower 13 bits, you could also run this mechanism, for example, in J9039 network. So if you have, and there are networks out there where J1939 and can open runs in parallel in the same network. And then, so still, it wouldn't harm it because I only use the lower 13 bits. And another thing is, actually, it sounds a little bit complicated, but it can easily be implemented. On the next slide, I have an example how it could be implemented with a little bit of pseudo code. In this case, it's C code, and it shows, or it's supposed to show, how to calculate the next CAN ID for the negotiation. And as you can see, it's not that much. And with the microcontroller technology nowadays, as Olaf just said, this is actually nothing for the microcontroller. So it's not even a waste of resources. What we did in the proof of concept, of course, we tried it out before we published the paper. So we created nodes which all started at the same time. And then we enabled our CAN analyzer pretty much that he could actually interpret these messages, because otherwise, yeah, we wanted to show that it's actually working. So we enabled our CAN analyzer to interpret, and then here you can actually see very good what kind of message that was on the bus and who's trying to claim and or try to negotiate a node ID. That's all. As I said, if you're really interested how it works and have a little bit more deeper details, you can read my paper. I will be available at the CAN Coffee later on, or you just drop me an email. The email is on the last slide, as you can see. Yeah, thank you.